Hey everybody, my name is Evan Williams. I'm the executive director at the Northwest New Mexico Council of Governments. Today we'll be going over what we like to call project tiering, everything from taking a project idea all the way to implementation and construction. This training was part of the New Mexico Infrastructure Capital Improvement Plan workshop series in 2020. We originally produced this in July of 2020, and we are updating it to provide an extended version of that training. So, as a quick background, the Northwest New Mexico Council of Governments is one of seven COGS, or Economic Development Districts, in the state of New Mexico. We are here to plan and develop our regions to help New Mexico become a stronger state. So our region is the three counties and all the communities in San Juan, McKinley, and Cibola counties. Basically, we're the New Mexico portion of the Four Corners. A quick snapshot of our region. We cover 15,000 square miles, which if we were a state, we'd be ranked 42nd behind West Virginia. So a huge land base. We serve over 235,000 people. So our rural, we have a very rural population density, making infrastructure and connecting people and economies more difficult than most places in the United States. We also serve four tribal communities, several land grants, many water associations and esequias, and different forms of governmental entities and subdivisions of the state. We're a quasi-governmental agency made up of our members that came together in articles of agreement, basically putting their hands in the huddle and saying we need someone to look after our interests from a regional perspective. There's things that we could all do alone, but we can do better together. So our members form the basis of the Council of Governments. We have a dual designation, one as a District 1 Planning and Development District for the state of New Mexico by executive order. We have a contract with local government divisions to provide technical assistance to communities and governments in our region. We also have a designation from the U.S. Economic Development Administration as an economic development district. And so we're responsible for the regional comprehensive economic development strategy plan for our region, as well as helping to liaison to the federal government for EDA investments into infrastructure that create jobs and attract private investment. So you can see we're made up of a board of directors. I'm the executive director, and we operate with several consultants. We have a robust planning team, a program development team. We've got one administrative assistant, and most of our financial and accounting is outsourced. We do have a pretty wide berth of programs that we put into three silos. So we have local and regional government services. We have our base programs, our contracts with EDA and New Mexico Department of Transportation for our regional transportation planning organization. And then we have a Center for Regional Innovation, again, looking for common problems to find regional solutions. So without further ado, this leads me into our topic and my presentation for today. Again, this is all about trying to position yourself to get projects funded and completed. This program used to be called How to Fund It. Today we're doing kind of planning, vetting, application, and funding. So we'll take you through several areas that will hopefully benefit you and your communities in finding the money and getting the money. So again, we call it project tiering. It's everything from project idea to the ribbon cutting, and even beyond that in terms of asset management. Jeff Kiley, our former executive director, kind of coined this new paradigm for infrastructure planning, development, and financing, and what he describes as full cycle planning, meaning we're planning every day, it's adaptable. It's not just a plan that sits on the shelf and we take it down once a year maybe and dust it off. We're doing planning all the time and integrating that into our project hearing. And so projects are constantly being developed at the local level. And we're constantly looking at timelines, roles, implementation plans to move those projects from idea to investment grade projects. And then full cycle funding is really all about, in the good old days, it used to be you go to one funder, they fund the project, you get it done. Now you've got to create a portfolio of investments from the public sector and other sources to help fully fund a project. So you need to take a 360 degree look at all possibilities for grant funding, financing, loans, private sector foundations, and all of those take different applications. They take working with a variety of funders and programs and understanding those things. So again, in our mind, we're planning 365 days a year, and we're looking at a 360 degree perspective on funding. So full cycle planning, full circle funding. Again, I just wanted to give you some perspective on how we kind of look at things. Most politicians and leaders, they want to get it done. They want to get it done yesterday. Projects do take a while to get planned and developed, designed, find the funding, and get constructed. And depending on the scope of the project, larger projects can take decades to get done. And you can see some of the ones that we've worked on in our region and how long they've taken from kind of that conceptual stage all the way to where they are now being completed. Again, getting big things done takes time. One of the things we say in our shop is the impossible just takes a little longer. Resources, again, we're being asked to do more with less all the time. In reality, you do less with less. And so we need to be very strategic of how we can leverage resources that are available to us and that we can put into our toolbox. So the person in the middle really is a city manager, for us, Navajo chapter manager. It's really the person that's responsible for the government institution, and they have a balancing act to do. They have to give and operate quality government services. The folks walking in the door that need help, that need support, and those are your day-to-day activities. And then at the same time, we're being asked to be strategic and proactive and think ahead and be ready for the next crisis to hit. And so some of the things that can help on the strategic side, there should be similar resources in most communities. So you have your officials that were voted in, elected, that are responsible for the policy. And so finding out what that policy vision is from the officials can be very important. And then committees, there's several land use committees and planning and zoning committees that can be helpful to help deal with some of these longer term policy type decisions. And also you have staff that has institutional knowledge, they have experience, they're a wealth of information. Every entity should have some sort of community plan, whether it's a comprehensive plan, a growth management master plan, a land use plan, a 40-year water plan. There should be a document that looks at the vision for the community, not just for tomorrow, but 20 years down the road at least. And that plan really should be a guiding document to really help you start breaking down from a 20-year vision, kind of a 5-year priority list of projects that help move you towards those goals and that vision. We just start breaking that down from the 20 years to the 5 years. And then every year you have a budget. You say, which one of those priorities do we want to invest our own financial resources in? What's our top priority? And so that local budget will inform how the policy officials are placing resources where the priorities are. Again, this concept of full cycle planning, full circle funding, again, the infrastructure capital improvement plan is really your 5-year roadmap for getting projects moving, improvements done, moving your community towards that vision. With the ICIP, each project should have kind of a scope. It should have a resource development plan, you know, back of the napkin type resource development plan, all the way to really lining out the funding sources that you're going to go after to help you partner up to get this project done. Project prospectus is really just a one pager of the critical information that any grant, any funder, anyone in the community would need to understand your project, understand the goals of the project, understand the resource needs, understand the budget, the breakdown. So these are tools that you can develop over time to really help you look like you're being very strategic and act like you're being proactive. Again, technical assistance providers, there's people like the COGS, there's people like RCAC, Rural Water Association, state agencies. They can all provide you some insights, some learning, some guidance on how to kind of get in the game. And again, don't invent the wheel. Go and find these Sherpas that can help start you up the mountain. So again, planning, in my mind, there's really just kind of two kinds of plans. There's a good plan, which is one that you use. A bad plan is one that just sits on the shelf and collects dust. You don't have to be a professional planner to do a good plan. It really comes down to it's a tool. It needs to be adaptable and usable, and you have to evaluate against it. So Dwight Eisenhower had the famous quote, "I have always found that plans are useless, but planning is indispensable." And so again, the process with planning is important. That's why we say we'd like to do it every single day, is looking at that plan, checking in with it. So again, you think about a plan, you develop a plan, you implement that plan, and then you assess that plan, and you keep getting better and better and drilling down deeper and deeper into that planning process. And so for me, it's really about the act of doing and implementing a plan than it is just planning for planning's sake. This is an image that comes to me from Eric Jihadi, a planner with North Central, former planner with North Central Economic Development District. And I thought this was pretty apt because projects are like icebergs. So typically with an iceberg, you only see the top. And so the top of the iceberg really is that final completion, you know, that ribbon cutting, the press release, the party that comes with completing a huge project for your community. And usually that's what leaders and officials are into, and that's all they really see. And so to get to that point is everything that's under the water that really no one sees or recognizes. And so that's the planning, the design, all of the issues that rise up with getting funding, getting rejected, getting to construction where you're just at the starting line. So now you have construction management, you've got all kinds of public concerns you've got to deal with. So all those things are the steps that are under the water. And I just do recognize and celebrate that many of you watching this are projecteers, as we would call you, the ones that get it done under the water. And I really applaud you, because without you, your communities would not move forward. It's unsung work sometimes, but again, it's about the most valuable thing. And of course, you'll always see the final product above the water and be able to tell your kids and grandkids that you were part of that and made it work. So again, projects take a long time, and a lot of that blood, sweat, and tears is not seen by everybody. Again, for today, we're going to go through some learning objectives. I'm going to kind of just kind of cut through this as best as possible. So we're going to go through preparation, doing your homework, getting things in order. Again, to be successful, you've got to have a foundation. Like any good house, you don't start building without that foundation. And so that's paramount to this process. We're going to go through tactics. You got to know the ball game. You don't have to treat it like a game, but you sure do need to know the rules and how to play it and how to position your community for success. We're going to go through focus. Trying to do 1,000 different things is less likely to be successful than doing 5 things well. And so we're going to go through how you can help your community vet projects and do prioritization. And then we're going to talk about applications. We're going to get into a little detail there on how grant writing is an art form. It's not just about how well you write, it's about what you write. It's about how you position your project again, how you champion and advocate for it. We're going to also talk about working smarter and not harder in that process, because grant writing can be daunting. And then funding, just increasing your chances of success. At the end of the day, it is about money and being able to attract those resources. So that's our lineup for today's session. We will move efficiently through this. So preparation, where do I start? That's the question I always get from folks. And so again, we kind of look at it as a funnel. And so really, you're starting with that strategic community plan that we talked about that has this 20-year vision. That should give you some guidance on where your community wants to go. It should give you data, demographics. It should talk about trends in your community. It should also have the goals, objectives, and hopefully some metrics by which you can gauge your performance and how you're moving towards those. Again, we'd really like to see that in the form of a strategic action plan, some kind of strategy plan that really helps with a 5-year perspective and starts boiling that vision down into some doable, focused items for kind of a 5-year window. That 5-year action plan should really fit right into your infrastructure capital improvement plan. Again, that's your 5-year prioritized projects and roadmap for your community. Can provide an inventory of assets. It can have short descriptions of your community and your process. And it should be helping inform a project and resource development plan for each of those projects. It should talk about what the project scope is. It should talk about what funding sources you're aiming to get or attract. And it should have roles and responsibilities and some timelining of who's doing what to move that project forward. And if you're a manager and you're managing that process, that really becomes a helpful plan for the community. It shouldn't be a wish list, it shouldn't be a shelf document. It should be something that actively you're taking out and you're really looking at that first year set of projects and really trying to get those done. Those should tie directly into your budget. Every year you submit, you approve a budget, and you have an audit. That's an important thing to establish a good financial track record, that when you do receive money, you are accountable, you're using it efficiently, getting projects in the ground, money turned around. Again, that 1-year budget really tells funders that you have skin in the game, that you're committed. Even if you have limited local resources, you know, even $1,000, $10,000, $20,000, the ball rolling and show that it's absolutely critical to you that you're putting your own money where your mouth is. Track record, again, this is lifetime, but it is redeemable. So again, we talked about the audit. If you have audit issues, you need to get those corrected. Funding agencies just kind of start looking at communities, both your audit and the findings, but also how you've done in the past. And it creates a track record. And so past performance, spending what you already have is very important. Again, the success breeds success. And so if you've been able to demonstrate that you can put millions of dollars in the ground, you're likely to get millions more. If you have a bad track record, it's likely that entities and funders will know that. And there isn't really a blacklist, but folks, again, tend to want to invest their dollars where they're going to see them put to the best use. Again, in terms of preparation, do your homework. Just like you tell your kids, got to do your homework. This has a short shelf life, but it's highly recyclable. So if you develop project plans and scopes and a project prospectus that helps, again, until that project is completely funded, you can use that over and over, tweak it, adapt it, perfect it. So all of that homework is good. Making sure you know the grant programs. Are you eligible? What are the requirements? Create a checklist of exactly, you know, letters of support, resolution, you know, press releases, testimonials, public support, petitions, whatever is needed for each of those grants, making sure you have a clear idea of how to clear and compete for those dollars. Again, collect file supporting documents. You can keep all this, preliminary engineering reports, right-of-way documents, photographs, before and after, flood, all those things that help sell a project. Just keep a good file and start doing that homework so when it's game time, you're ready to perform. This is actually a document that we put out to our members after the ICIP is completed. And basically what this document is it basically says, okay, you submitted your ICIP, now what? And the question is, so what now? And this really walks you through that. The ICIP is just kind of a prerequisite for applying. It's not the application to funding sources. So a lot of times people stop me and say, hey, when am I going to get that money? And I say, what money? And what did you apply for? Well, I did my ICIP and I put down that I wanted, you know, X, Y, and Z. When am I going to get it? That's not how this works. The Infrastructure Capital Improvement Plan is really an internal tool to you. It is used by the governor and legislature to make sure that it's in alignment with what you're asking for. And several grant programs offer points and help and make sure that it is in your ICIP. So it's critical just as a starting point. You still need to apply and take those projects down the path of project tiering. So everything from idea stage to project planning to preparing a project to funding to construction to asset management. And that's graphed here. And then what we've done is we put kind of the bread and butter grant program. So we have, you know, transportation funding from DOT. We've got Water Trust Board for water projects. We've got the Community Development Block Grant. So this document basically links you to all the typical resources that we go after for various types of projects. And so this helps our members just, okay, we did our ICIP, what's next? And this is exactly what's next. So tactics. Again, what is my game plan to get this project done for my community? Again, your ICIP should help create kind of the top priority projects. And we typically recommend no more than five. Trying to concentrate on getting five done a year is actually a great feat to do. And so any more than that really takes you off your focus. If you can get it down to three, it's probably even better. But again, knowing what those top priority projects are, making sure all of your officials, you know what those top three are, just in case they see a legislator in the grocery store, they know exactly what they're asking for. And then we talk about phasing projects. Sometimes we can't get funding for the whole kit and caboodle. We have to do our planning and we get some money for that. We work on design, we get some funding for that, and then we go after construction. And even construction can be phased. We do a block at a time, or we do this first water line extension, and then we come back and do the second phase. And so each of those kind of has its own budget, its own time frame, and its own funding strategy. And so it's easier to get a chunk funded and done than it is to try to bite off the whole project. Develop a project action plan, plan for the process. Again, just taking your projects and understanding what steps you're going to have to take, what actions you're going to have to take, what time frames, and who's responsible. Again, if the deadline is December 30th for a grant or the Tribal Infrastructure Fund or Water Trust Board, work backwards on all the steps it's going to take to submit that grant. And so you can work backwards from the deadline to create that project action plan. You can do that on a piece of paper. You can do that online. You can set up your own system to do that. But it's very important to have that and to check in regularly on how it's going, what are the issues. So it's not just, you know, the last day and we're going to pull this grant off. Typically, that can't happen that way. Develop a strategy to tell your story. This is something I just can't underline enough. You think about competition in the state of New Mexico. You think about national competition, the federal sources. Everybody needs everything. And so, you know, funding sources are like, man, there's just so many needs out there. The same thing. It's kind of like a resume. Everybody is the greatest candidate to slice bread. But what's going to separate you from those others? And developing and crafting a story really becomes something that catches the attention of those sources. So whether you do that with photos or you collect media and presentations and press releases to help talk about your problems and where you've been and the assets and what you've done and how you've brought the community together. But know the audience, you know, why should I care? If I'm a state legislator, you know, I get thousands of requests. Why is this one different? Why should I invest in this? And why should I invest in you and your community? And so telling a good story, again, not fabricating stories, but telling your story and being very, very proactive and very clear and articulate about that. And again, doing it in multimedia approaches. So video, pictures, all of those things can help differentiate you from the others. Getting to the hopper. This is all about, you have your ICIP, you've got your comprehensive plan, and your number one project in both those documents is a power line extension to your community, to your neighborhood. Is that project listed in regional plans? We work on several regional plans. We've got a regional water plan. We've got a regional transportation plan. We've got a regional economic development strategy plan. All of those plans articulate maybe not exact projects, but types of projects. And so being listed in regional plans and then state plans and making sure you're on these priority lists is very important. To be able to point to legislators and say, see, it's not just us telling you this, it's the whole region that's talking about how important these type of projects, our project is to the process. So get yourself on different lists, on different plans, and get incorporated into those and be able to reference them. Get support, again, resolutions, letters of support, petitions, testimonials. All those things tell funders that it's not just you asking, it's not just an official, it's the community, it's that neighborhood, it's something that fires everybody up and everybody's on the same page and wants. Again, be your best advocate or champion. I know lots of communities have lobbyists that go to Santa Fe and advocate on your behalf. There's no one better than you, and there's no one that a legislator or a funding source wants to see than the actual person that lives in that community and someone that can speak from the heart. It doesn't have to be all the fancy words or any of that. It just needs to be from the heart. And again, if you can get over your fear of speaking and advocating, you will do an excellent job being your own champion. And that's what people respond to, is that passion and that person that comes from the community, that knows the community, knows what they need, and is there and is present trying to get it done. So that's the tactics. That's knowing the game and kind of what your plan to attack the game is going to be. So again, just a little bit more on 365, 360. So full cycle planning, full circle funding. Again, this is kind of how we have coached ourselves and coached others in our region. Again, plan throughout the whole year, create well-described project prospectuses and budgets. And again, there's a cost estimating workshop that's integrated with ICIP that'll help you if you don't know that. You can also work with engineers and architects that'll help you find those numbers and those values to put in. But again, knowing exactly how much you need is very important to that. And then seeking investments from a variety of sources that might be available. And knowing what those sources are, knowing what time of year to get things positioned and timed well. So again, we kind of go through a little bit of the life of a project. Again, just kind of defining it from an idea. We get a lot of ideas from a lot of people, and some of them are very good. Some of them are that's why we have public input, is to get these ideas, because sometimes we're too close to it, or sometimes we think we know it. But community members just point out, wouldn't it be great if this road went to that road and we had a bypass so that we didn't have all this traffic, truck traffic, et cetera. So sometimes projects can be, good projects come from anywhere. But again, an idea is not ready for prime time. So we really need to define that idea, we need to plan, we need to do some feasibility work, we need to do a preliminary engineering report. And so we start working on defining that project and planning it. So that's really kind of phase two. And then as we start, again, kind of funnel approach, as we start getting down to it, we really want to get into the details. So we're designing that project, we're testing soils, we're making sure there's not environmental issues, that we have the right-of-way. That we're talking about utility designation and mapping. We've got easements, we've got construction drawings. We're getting the cost, not just from a swag, but actually nuts and bolts of what it's really gonna cost to get that project done. And then final design takes it a little bit further, kind of from a 30% design all the way to 90. You get some plan specs and estimates, you get some bid documents. All of these things, again, the funnel is kind of getting more and more detailed of what the project is, but also the cost is growing. So planning takes few dollars, a couple dollars here and there. The design starts to be 10% of your construction cost or more. And so you start paying, you need more funding and more grant funding. So then once we're fully designed, basically what they call a shovel-ready project, we're ready for construction, including construction letting, all the way to field engineering, construction administration, closing out projects. And so that whole construction project is its own phase and can be phased within itself, like we talked about before. And then once we get the project done, we can't just let that road deteriorate or not check on that water line or not do our testing on the wastewater. We need to asset manage, we need to operate, maintain, and even at some point replace that project. And so there's a life of the project after the ribbon gets cut. And that's a process that Mexico is really putting an emphasis on. We're helping you get an asset. We really want to make sure you're taking care of that asset, because it's a lot more expensive to replace than it is to do the routine maintenance and repair that project. So again, project development, and this you can kind of go through on your own. But again, it's moving from idea to investability to sustainability. And that's really what we're trying to get all of our communities in New Mexico to understand, to talk about, and to get done. So again, this is just another way of looking at it. And a lot of these resources and templates are on our website. at our project tiering site, so you can actually use these with your community. You can educate, you know, it's kind of a train the trainer process. I train you, you train another person or persons, and we keep this knowledge moving. So again, this is more about investment grade, moving from the beginning stages, again, the idea stages, that really aren't fundable by the funders or by resources. So they're not going to give you money for just an idea until it's crafted. And so moving a project from kind of a grade E status into intermediate is kind of, again, defining the project, doing the planning, getting some design. And so you're moving that project up to hopefully be an advanced project, a high degree of readiness. So grade B, grade A, shovel ready, those kind of buzzwords. But really it's, you know, not only do I have this fully, you know, planned, fully designed, I've got matching funds, I've got commitments from other partners to come in. What I need from you is just the remainder to get this project done. That's when funders really come out of the woodwork, and all of a sudden they want in on your project, because you've got it to an investment grade that really is fully developed. So again, just that full cycle funding approaches, these are just some of the sources that we typically go to, starting with, you know, local budget, skin in the game, sweat equity, in-kind, all those things that you can do from a local level, including matching funds or, you know, increasing rates so that you can bond for a water system improvement. All those things need to be vetted by yourself first so you can create that story to go and attract other resources. But these are just some of the programs, and again, there's more information on all of them on their websites, and we can get into detail if you have questions on any of these. But they're complex applications for sure, in a lot of cases. Okay, so getting some focus. How do I vet projects and set priorities? Again, if it was just you or your household, it'd be easy. You wouldn't have to work with anybody else. But this is kind of a community consensus process, getting your officials to agree, comparing apples, oranges, and bananas, and figuring out which one stacks up to the highest. So again, we would recommend that you start with your high CIP. A lot of that work's already been done. Some of it's year after year, so it's well vetted. Remember, the ICIP is a state requirement that can be your local priority list or not. So many of the folks that we work with, they have an ICIP, which they submit to the state, but they even take that list further and they have their own internal capital improvement planning process. So they have their list. It's the same kind of overview. It's just got some state investment projects on it, whereas there might be local investment projects that you're going to budget for, that you're going to get done with your own resources. So they actually boil it down and tie their budget to their own CIP process. So they've got kind of a wish list of everything the public might have asked for. They get it into the ICIP, which is a prioritized list for the city or the community and the state. But then they also have their internal document, which they're really focused on their own resources and doing. And so again, the ICIP shouldn't be a wish list. It should be prioritized and vetted. So again, you can start with the ICIP and start moving things from that perspective. So again, decide on the universe. For example, the current year, whatever year we're in, the first year in the ICIP only, you can take those projects. So if you have 400 projects in the first year, that's your universe. If you've got it down to 10 or 5, then really that's the focus. And the more that you can get it down, the easier vetting and prioritization will be. But you need to decide on the parameters for your community. You know, right now, one of the things that communities are doing are focusing on the economic recovery projects that not only are important to your community, part of your broader vision, but that can get the economy moving. you know, projects, infrastructure projects that can get downtown businesses back up and running, give them spaces and tables to move outside to generate more space and more resources. Again, it could just be projects in my district, looking at one council district or one legislative district. But again, decide on the universe and start from there. Then decide on a method. You know, there's 100 different examples. We'll have some in this slideshow. We can talk about others. I would just say keep it simple. But you can do, you know, voting. We've all done the dots. You can do force ranking processes. You can do paired comparison, Q sorts, prioritization metrics. You can give them point scores. You can do it any way you want, but decide on a method, get agreement on how that process is going to work. Don't try to game the system. Set it up so everybody has the same understanding and get down the road on it. So again, facilitate a prioritization session with your leaders. So if you're the manager, or if you're a COG director and you're asked to facilitate this process, again, use that method, use the universe, use the method, and then help them build consensus around the choices. Identify capital improvement priorities and help that, and allow that process to focus internal resources. Again, it's all about coming out with consensus so that everybody can speak with one voice, because that's what it's going to take to pull resources down. This is kind of, you know, some of this is very simple once you say it, but if you don't do it, you don't do it. So again, if you have a list of priorities, print them and put them in a public place. Remind people. I've got one municipality in my region that prints out on a laminated piece of paper, and every meeting they have it in their packet, and it's the first thing that they review before they start their meeting, what the priorities are. Because again, if you're going to put a new priority in, you need to take one out. And so again, if you have consensus on those priorities, post them, hold yourself accountable to them, and then create project tiering strategy. So again, the project resource and development plans, action plans, financial financing strategies, what grants are we going to do at what time. We have a $3 million project. We're going to get $1 million here, $1 million there, $1 million over there. We're going to pull it all together. We're going to get construction ready by the time the spring comes so that we can fit it in our construction window. Get detailed on your project tiering strategies. And then again, make those people, you know, once they've gone through the process, they're your champions. They know why they needed 100 different things, and they got down these 5 things, and they really got to have them. And give those people, you know, help them craft the story and send them where they need to go to make sure that voice, that collective voice, is being heard. Again, these are just examples that you can pull from. We've got some of these tools on our website, but you know, don't get worried about which one is the best method. The best method is the one that gets you to your priorities. So you pick one, you use it, you work through it, and it'll give you different ways to put values on things, to prioritize them, and to make sense again of how do you compare a transportation project to a water project, to a wastewater system improvement. These type of prioritization methods can help you do that. So again, this is one I just kind of came up with on the fly right before this presentation. There's a couple examples in the lower left, but prioritization should be based on the shared vision and values of a community set by the leadership. And so the main chart on here, it just has two scalable features. It has impact. What's going to be the impact of this project? Is it going to be low, or is it going to be high? And then we're going to evaluate readiness. Is it ready to go? Does it have all the things we've talked about? So you evaluate low to high. And again, if it's high, then that's a priority. And you could actually map these into the quadrants based on scoring. If it has a high impact, but it's not ready, phase it, get the plan done, get the design done. If it's got high readiness, but low impact, reconsider it. Maybe it's not ready for this year. Until you get through the other projects that have higher impact, you know, just keep it on the list, but bring it back and prioritize it later. If it's low and low, it's probably not a priority for this year. It's probably in an out year. It's probably in your parking lot. And again, just being able to quickly do that and get consensus around it, even if you can't get the top five in order, this will at least get the top five into that top quadrant. So you can, again, kind of start taking down that universe into a actionable sense of information. Again, this has to be done with the leadership. They're the ones that got voted in. They're the ones that set the policy. They need to be educated about projects and understand them. But they are the ones responsible for making the community vision happen. Funding, not to be excluded. Increasing your chances for success. Again, do your homework. You know, I won't say 90% of the process is doing your homework, but man, you can cut through it pretty quick if you've got everything kind of lined up. Again, getting in the hopper. Are you in the local plan? Are you in the regional plans? Are you in the state plans? Does the cabinet secretary know about your project? That's what we're talking about, getting it out there, not just keeping it to yourself. Oh, we need this water line so much. Hey, does the environment department know about it? Do people in Santa Fe and DC, do they know about your project? That's the hoppers we want to get into. Again, learn and be the buzzwords. Talk the talk, walk the walk. We may not like all the things that are changing in our lives and the world, but to be successful, some of it we have to incorporate. And we can't just say it, you know, this is a shovel-ready project. And then when I ask them, you know, has your land been withdrawn or do you have site control on that land? They say, oh, no, we, you know, we'll get that done. Well, you're not shovel-ready if you don't have all those things on the checklist. And it's very easy for someone to find out. So you gotta walk the walk. If it's regional project, that's a big buzzword. It's going to help more than your community. It's a big major highway that's going to connect everybody. It's a regional thing. It's not just your small community, but it's a bunch of communities. You can talk about how it's a regional priority. Again, those are things that funding sources really want to get to, because if they fund, you know, a senior center in every community, they don't regionalize those facilities, run out of money very quickly. So they want to help the most amount of people with the fixed resources that they have. Again, shovel ready. We got to be really shovel ready. And just to tell you, there's probably no shovel ready project. That's probably a misnomer. There's always something that still has to be done or still has to be checked off. But the closer you can get to shovel ready, the better. Opportunity zones. These are new IRS designations to help kind of spur some private investment to underserved communities. Underinvested communities. And so that's a new opportunity. Do you know if you're in an opportunity zone or not? Have you researched that program? Is that an opportunity for your projects or economic development? So again, there's every year, this is a constant changing world, but you kind of need to know where the trends are and what funders are doing. I remember the days with Governor Richardson, he'd have a year of water. Well, if you didn't have a water project, you're kind of out. If you did, you just move it right in. So you needed to know and anticipate where the investment strategies for the state, for the feds is going to be. Again, elections have consequences. New people always want to create a new program. You've got to be kind of tracking that stuff. Again, being your fierce advocate, you've got to be the one telling the story. You've got to keep coming after people. You take no for an answer. I don't mean to... You know, we're not beating anybody up here, but again, being a little bit forceful in terms of, hey, you know, we've talked about this. We really need this. You know, can I call you? Can I come visit you? Staying on it. Don't take no for an answer when it's when no means no, but keep advocating for your community the best way that you can. So one of those examples, and I really like this, one of my communities uses this pretty well. Instead of going out and chasing 9 different sources and doing 9 different grants, even though eventually they will have to do that, instead of doing that, they actually bring the 9 resources, the funders, to their community, put their project in the middle of the table, present to everybody all at once. And then they have people kind of like Shark Tank. Well, if you can do this for them and this project, I can do this, or we can make this work. And they just start going after it kind of like Shark Tank. How do we get investments into this great project? And so again, bringing people to your community, getting a sense of where you're at, where your community's at, especially if you're looking for a new facility, put them in the old facility and let them understand that there's asbestos and no heat and the water, the bathroom works a couple times a year. They'll get a sense of what you need and they'll be receptive. So again, use that regional funders roundtable, get with a couple different partners, bring those funders in and put some projects in front of them. A great way to kind of flip the script there. Be accountable for the money you get. Track record is paramount. Again, we talked about this before. I'm just going to read this because this never makes sense to me, but it makes a ton of sense. It is easier to get the money than it actually is to spend it correctly and efficiently. So as much as difficult as it is getting grants and funding, it's actually easier to get that than it is to really do efficient and spend correct and get reimbursed and do the reporting and all the things that come with the funding. So again, it's easier to get the money than it is to spend it correctly. Getting the grant is only the start. Be ready for the rest. A lot of communities overextend themselves trying to get a number of projects done. Like we talked about, keep it down to 3 or 5, no more than 10 if you've got the capacity, but know your capacity. These grants take a lot of time to spend the money correctly. And again, if we don't do that, we start losing money, money goes back, we start getting a bad reputation. So again, know your capacity, know what, you know, it's better to get 3 things done efficiently than try to do 10 things and get nothing done. Again, celebrate and promote success. Success breeds success. So if you have 10 funders that funded your project, you get them out there, you congratulate them, you thank them, you give them the pozole and make everybody happy. And even for yourself and your team and your staff and your officials, it's just important to take that time to mark it down that, hey, we worked really hard and this is what we were able to achieve, because it helps to build off of that for the next time, and you can go even further and you can get bigger things done. But you got to remember to take a breath and to really celebrate and promote that success. Get it out on the paper and the radio, because like I said, the funding source may say, hey, you know, that community's really rocking. We want to get in on their next project. So again, success breeds success. So one of my planners, this is a tool that we use to make sure we're timing projects and timing applications. So this is the annual project tiering cycle. It takes those resources we've been showing you, the bread and butter type programs, and it lines out all the details. You know, this is when it comes out. This is the first application phase. This is the due date. This is has to go through the legislature. This is when capital outlay comes out. So it goes through a number of those resources. Again, this is up on our website. I think Brandon Howe did an excellent job putting this together. It puts everything you need to know for these base programs on one page. And so you can tell what you need to do each season to get your project. It can help with your project action plans. Coaches, who do we ask? This question comes up all the time. Again, if you're brand new, if you've been there a while, it doesn't matter. There's people out there that know, that live and breathe these programs. And again, they change almost annually in some former fashion. So check in with them, sit down with them, take some time. But these are some for our region that we've worked with. We tell people, you know, these are the folks that you need to get to know. So there's lots of technical assistance providers, including the COGS. We get paid to give you these secrets to help you get it done. And we want our region, the COGS are competitive. We want our region to do better than everyone else. You know, we believe that by teaching this and showing you the tricks of the trade, you know, that iron sharpens iron. And so as you get stronger, we all grow and learn and get stronger. And that's really what it's all about. So at the very bottom, it says other entities like yours, you know, find a mentor, find a role model, check in. If there's another city manager that's been doing it for 40 years, I mean, sit down with them, pick their brain, understand, you know, what they do, how they do it, especially the ones that are really successful. You want to get to know them, have lunch, take them out, pick their brain, check in, get guidance. Again, that having a good coach makes you a good player. And so you'll perform at a much higher rate by understanding and getting in these circles. Okay, so application. How do I work smarter and not harder? This is one of the slides I really have taken some time in my career, over 18 years of this, to really hone down as best as possible. So speaking of honing it, narrowing the field. So lots of entities and lots of leaders say, you know, there's tons of grant money out there. Just go shake the tree and get it. And then you find out, well, we didn't really want that funding because it's not exactly what we're trying to do. So again, what we talk about is there's several places to find grant opportunities, but you need to be able to filter them, funnel the ones that fit, and then follow up with those. Again, being the first can be the worst. So, you know, lots of grant programs are looking for innovation. They're looking for changes. They're not just funding things that are typical. And so you may have typical things that you need to get done. You don't want a grant that's holding you accountable for something that's groundbreaking, that you're going to use artificial intelligence in your transportation system when you really just wanted to get a road paved. So again, you need to evaluate whether the grant program really fits your need, your problem, your project. What we talk about is, yeah, cast a large net on grants and review everything. But once you find, once you're looking, do not take a scatter approach. You know, don't put buckshot in and shoot at everything. Really find the ones that are the targets that hit the mark for you, and really aim and fire at those. It's just, you know, you could spend a lot of time writing lots of grants and getting none of them. Spend the time to narrow the field and narrow the focus and really take careful aim at a target and hit it. Competition is stiff. This is probably an understatement. You know, there's thousands of communities, everybody needs something. So you're going to have to find a way to stand out. You know, what is your hook? What is your story? What is your element that's going to make the difference? You know, there's tons of communities out there. Worked with the City of Grants in the past to help them compete nationally. They were one of 10 communities that got put into this new program, recreation economies for rural communities. And really, the whole thing was crafting that story that made Grants New Mexico stand out in the whole United States. And that's not an easy thing to do, but there's lessons in that, and understanding how people did that, and checking in on the ones that won and figuring out how they got, you know, getting a copy of their grant, figuring out what they did, learning from it, modeling your community. Those are important things, but you know, the competition is stiff, and, you know, you should see what the success rate for grants is. You know, if it's less than 1% in the whole country, that may not be something that you want to spend your time working on. You may want to find something that's got a 50%, where they're giving out 75 awards in the whole country. You know, those things are very important to understand from the beginning. So, you know, grant writing is not easy, but it's really not rocket science. They give you the call for projects, request for proposal. You follow it. You read every line and every detail, and you follow the instructions. If they're not clear, you ask. You do not assume anything. You talk to the project officer. Hey, I've got a question. This doesn't make sense to me. But again, you have to follow. If it says 11-point font, you use 11-point font. If you use 12, you're out. If there's a page limit, you better hit that page limit. Grants written for projects, you know very well. So again, there's lots of grants for lots of things, but you should write to things that you really know about, that you know the story, you know where this project's been, you have the history, you know the plan, you know the design, you know the funding levels. Again, it'll be easier to write about something that you know like the back of your hand. And it'll be obvious when you write things from the funder's perspective that you don't know. So again, just follow the letter of that RFP or whatever that grant application is. Again, tell your story. There's no one that knows you or your community like you. Paint the picture. I mean, you can't use pictures, paint it in words. But they don't know where we live in New Mexico, if it's in D.C., and even for us out here in Santa Fe sometimes. They don't know what the conditions are on the ground, so don't take it for granted that they will look it up. You know, we're in Grants, New Mexico. We're on Route 66. We've got I-40. We've got the Burlington Northern Transcom line. Mount Taylor is in our background or in our backyard. Start giving them some of that detail so that they can understand where you're coming from. Illustrate to the people who've never been there. You know, it's a hard thing to do, but you've got to make people that may not understand where you live, you know, understand your values and understand where you come from and understand the setting in which you live. Summary goals and beyond. Again, crafting a 400-page application is easy. It's getting it down into a one-page executive summary that could be almost impossible. If I had more time, I would have wrote a shorter summary, you know, that old adage. But it should be written last, the summary, after you've got all the details. But the summary is that hook. I mean, that is illustrating the story. You know, getting it down to the nuts and bolts of what you want to tell somebody. It's your elevator speech. And it may be the only thing that the grant reviewers look at. And if you pass that, they look at the rest. But that's got to get their attention. It has to be well-crafted. Get someone else to proofread it. You know, ask professionals, ask a librarian. Get some help on tightening up that summary. That's got to be your best foot forward. Goals, you really have to be able to tell them, you know, specific, measurable, actionable, realistic, and based on time. You've got to be able to put those SMART goals into an application. I think the A is actually attainable. So anyway, look that up. But get your goals into that sense. That's what a lot of grants want. They don't want this, well, if you build it, they will come. No, they want specific, measurable, attainable, realistic and time-based goals. If you build this road, I've got these three businesses that will move there tomorrow. This is how many people they're going to employ. Here's the wage range. You've got to have that type of detail now. It's not enough just to say, hey, we're a needy community. We're disinvested. You know, we just need some help here. No, it's what are your assets? What are you bringing to the table? What are the goals and outcomes we can count on you to bring in? It's a different level in grant writing than it used to be. And it's more asset-based than it's been on needs-based. Everybody has similar needs. And so it's really about how your community is going to take this investment and make a difference, make an impact in your community. Evaluation and funding it forward. So, you know, how are you going to evaluate if this is working? There's evaluation plans. There's people that have done this. I would check in with them. But you've got to, it can't just be like, well, we're going to count the number of people that drive down this road. No, we're going to count the number of people that drive down this road. We're going to figure out how much money they spent at these different stores because of this new road. You've got to get into a whole level of evaluation to help them understand what the impact's going to be. And once the road's built, you need to tell them how you're going to take care of it. Do you have the operations and maintenance funds in your budget? How are you going to fund it forward? Most people want to fund you and they don't want you coming back. So they want to know, once I give you the 7 police vehicles, that every year you're going to put money away for a new police vehicle and we're not going to get into this backlog again. So those are good things to explain in your grants. Some do's and don'ts. Do make contact with the grant officer. Again, asking questions, showing them that you're really taking this serious, getting them to know where you are, who you are, is a good thing. Again, don't do anything inappropriate, but do get to know them. I mean, you know, it is a partnership relationship between a funder and a funding source and the person receiving the funds. Do develop a template proposal for reuse. Again, a one pager, something that you can create that has the basic information. So, you know, if you want to talk about the history of the city of Grants and how it got started and the different economies and the boom bust cycles, have all that written. Have it ready to cut and paste. Move it right in, including your data, all of your sources. If you have all that stuff, for one application, you can reuse it over and over again and do update it at some point. Do read the entire proposal before writing. So read the whole RFP and make your notes and understand, because sometimes you get to the end and you're like, oh, wait, we don't qualify for this. So don't put in a bunch of time. Read the whole thing. Make sure you're clear that this is one that you want to take a rifle shot at. And that it really fits and it's really going to work for you. Do tackle each section separately, kind of go through them in detail, check and review them before kind of moving on, making sure it flows together. Don't guess on anything you don't understand. Again, contact that grant officer, get clarification. People get kicked out all the time because they assume something or they're afraid to call. Those people have jobs to help you understand those questions. They have frequently asked questions. They have places where you can actually ask the questions. They can publish clarifying information. So again, don't guess. Don't copy someone else's grant. It's good to get copies of winners, but you know, when all of a sudden it's the city of Grants and you're talking about New York City, someone's going to have a little bit of an issue with that. Or if you haven't changed some of the things and you're really just copying someone else's stuff, it's just not a good look. So again, learn from people's stuff, but definitely make it your own. Definitely make sure it represents your community and what you're going to do with the project. Don't submit without letters of support. This is important. There's some grants that probably don't allow you to, but again, get your county, get other entities, get state agencies, get other folks to take an interest in letters of support. A lot of grants are moving from letters of support, you know, form letters, to actually like letters of commitment. What is this partner going to do? What are they going to bring to the table? How are they going to help? And so you actually may want to start crafting letters of commitment. Getting folks not just in support and signing anything, but actually understanding what their role is in your project. That tells a lot more than a letter of support. Don't make up lies of things that you're not doing. So again, don't promise the world just to get the grant, because they're going to hold you accountable to that at some point, at some level. And so, you know, it just goes back to telling the truth. Let the chips fall where they may. It's something that you're not able to do and you're not going to get to, just don't fabricate that. Let it lie where it lies. Do the best you can, but stay honest. All right, so just a real quick aside. A lot of folks are queued in on Capital Outlay. It's a kind of a one-page form that's going electronic, so it's even easier than most grant applications. But you kind of need to know the names, know the game of the legislative process. Again, the odd years are 60-day sessions where everything flies. All legislation can get started in a 60-day process. Every even year is a 30-day. It's really just a budget session. There is a call from the governor, specific issues that the governor wants to get done. We start mid-January every year, and we go until that last day is accomplished. Typically with capital outlay, the sources are from severance tax. So again, every time that a mineral in New Mexico is severed from the earth, there's a tax on that. That tax in a five-year rolling average, the estimation of what that revenue is going to be, we're able to bond against that. And so capital outlay projects really need to be over 10 years because we're bonding for that long. And again, they need to be spent right away because the state of New Mexico can receive a penalty for arbitrage if we aren't spending the money. So again, in good years, there's some general fund, there's other funds that are put in the capital outlay, but for the most part, it's severance tax bonds. And so again, those resources don't happen every year, but again, when oil and gas is doing well, typically there'll be capital outlay. On the even years, we have general obligation bonds, and typically they're for four issues: senior centers, libraries, schools, and universities. And there's different processes for those. The senior centers have their own capital outlay process that's kind of starts right after the session. You start applying for the next year. And if it's a general obligation bond year, several projects will go into that list. But it can also go into severance tax, but they have their own prioritization process for that. So again, you'll need to get an understanding of that as well. Typically what happens is, you know, let's say there's 300 million. Well, let's go with the example, I guess. So if there's 450 million of severance tax capacity, typically half of it off the top goes to state projects, state agency projects and needs throughout the state. And then the other half will get broken down a third, a third, a third. And so what you have is the governor actually has the most amount of discretionary capital outlay. So you should be pulling her or him, depending on who's in charge, into your projects. It's very important that you're talking with the governor's office, you're working with the administration. And so there's less senators than representatives. So if it's divided evenly, which typically it is, your senator will have a little bit more money for his or her district than your representative. Again, you want to get all three, your senator, your representative, and the governor to kind of chip in to get larger projects done. And again, these forms are online on the New Mexico legislature website. Sometimes the governor has her own form, but they're moving towards a fully a kind of automated system that's tied into your ICIP. So whatever you put in your ICIP, it's spitting out that legislative language, which is really is a great, I mean, I just applaud it that they're moving that stuff so you don't have to continuously redo your ICIP and there's no connection. Now there's a direct connection to capital outlay. So doing your ICIP, doing it better, making it clearer is going to be important going forward. And then again, there's an executive order that's still standing that basically if you have audit findings, not submitting your budget reports on time, then you're not really eligible to receive a capital outlay. You're kind of on that bad spenders list. And they're not going to invest money until you've cleaned that up. So again, just in terms of more broad keys to the game, and this is where I wanted to go into a little more detail than I was able to in July. Some of the tips, you know, we've talked about reading the RFP in its entirety, again, making notes, using a highlighter, really getting those specific due dates, the checklist. That's what our staff does. The first thing we do is just really attack that RFP and get a good checklist and due dates and an action plan. Again, if you have narrative that you used before to describe your community, to put out the demographics, to talk about where you are in the world, tell your story. Again, preload that basic information into every application. It's usually consistent across the board that they're going to ask, you know, to describe your community, describe your project. So if you have that, just recycle it. Again, call your grant officer to clarify questions. You can also gain some insight. You know, sometimes that happens just with clarity and having a conversation that helps you key in on certain things that they're looking for. Separate yourself from other proposals. What makes your circumstance unique? Really finding that hook and using that to really explain and separate yourself from the competition. That's important to illustrate to people who have never been there. Again, we've talked about that. Evidence plus asset-based perspective. Why invest in you? And so again, build on your assets. Tell them how much skin in the game you've got. They're becoming more and more sophisticated. You know, it's not just the woe is me, my community is very poor, we've got these bad socioeconomics. It's okay, you know, lots of people have similar situations. How are you gonna take charge and reverse it, make an impact with our dollars? What assets are you gonna bring to bear? What partners? Tell us about, you know, make it positive. You know, well, yeah, we've been here, but we're making a change. We have new leadership. Here's where we're trying to get to. Here's evidence of our past success. Here's the assets we're bringing in. So again, you need to tell the demographic story and let the numbers speak for themselves, but really take a proactive and asset-based approach to your project and your narrative. Letters of commitment versus support. I kind of went through that. That's where things are headed. Because everyone's tired of reading the same form letter on 52 different templates signed by 52 different people. It doesn't mean much anymore. But again, if you don't have them, then it tells a lot that you didn't even try to get letters of support. So again, letters of commitment, letters of support, no letters of support. Keep moving up that chain to earn more points. Charts say more than straight narrative. So again, when you're explaining your demographics, getting into a nice chart, you know, versus explaining it for a page and a half, that's going to be really helpful for the reviewer to get the information. Make it clear in the chart what you're explaining. Don't leave anything out in terms of that. If you need some narrative, obviously, but charts are a good way to maximize pages and words and convey information in a straightforward way. Getting the grant is only at the start. Be ready for the rest. Again, you get into community development block grant, you better have some capacity and some time, and don't just dump this on the village clerk, because CDBG is a four-letter word for a reason, and it's because it has lots of federal regulations in terms of spending and reporting on that money. So again, be ready for that, and you know, apply to things that you have the capacity to get done correctly and efficiently. Try and try again. This is something that, again, is just it's something you tell a little kid, but if you don't get it the first, you know, lots of grants you won't get the first time around. They don't know who you are, they don't know your project, and it's a good way to vet communities. You know, if you're not willing to come back and try and make that application better, and earn points, and ask them why I didn't get this grant. Take me through a debrief. I want to know how many points I missed it by so I can perfect this. If you keep trying, you will be successful. It's the people that drop out that are never going to make it. And so again, try and try again, and don't try the same way. Don't just repackage, make it better every time. Figure out how you can succeed and make that application, investable. Track record's important. You just can't You know, if you're in a bad state, you got to get better, and get better first and then start applying. But really clean that up. Trends, again, regionalize. I mean, everything is moving towards less money. You want to help more people. You got to be able to tell your story into how your projects can regionalize. And then detailing your impact. You know, how are you going to evaluate it? How is this going to make your community better? How is it going to get you to that 20-year vision? Really tell them the detailed impact that you expect in the project. Need versus being ready. Again, you can't sell it on need. You got to have a shovel-ready project in a lot of cases. So you got to have that readiness. You can't fake that readiness. And so just keep working at each phase to get it more and more ready. Get it ready for what we call prime time. Finish what you start. If you get $1 million and you need three and you can't really build a bridge for less than three, again, just keep working to get that $3 million and spend it and finish what you start. Don't jump from, hey, this year we want a dog park, but then we got new politicians. Now we want a water project. Oh, no, wait, we got some money for that, but what we really wanted was, legislators are pretty clear. Hey, if we start investing in a project, we want to see it get complete. So I know things change with elections, but you really need to be able to finish what you start and then celebrate that and move to the next project. Matching and leveraging, again, one source doesn't get the job done anymore. You've got to have a portfolio of funders investing in your project. They're always going to want match. They're always going to want to be the last one in to make a project work. They're going to want to see leveraging on their money, return on investment. These are terms that everybody is kind of using, and you need to understand and use them back and use them to your benefit. Again, economic recovery. How does this project tie in with longer-term recovery after COVID-19? How does this help with social distancing? How does this stimulate the economy? These are going to be trends in the near future and upcoming years. More trends and recommendation, again, opportunity zones, COVID-19. Those are our major buzzwords right now. Recommendation is, do you have a recovery plan for your community? For your region, for the state? How does your project fit into all those plans? Are you in those hoppers? So have a plan and then figure out how your project helps move the recovery plan forward. Have a portfolio of investment grade projects. Just have them ready. There'll be funding opportunities outside of the CARES Act. There's going to be opportunities for those. So start building those projects now, the prospectuses, getting those things lined out, because it may only be for 2 weeks that you have an opportunity. You've got to turn it around or you're out. So start getting those ready. Read these trends, understand these recommendations. Grant funding will continue to decrease and become more competitive, with funding increasingly based on innovation and regional rather than local focus. Again, we've talked about that. So recommendation here is, you need to work with other groups, build larger coalitions, ready to roll partnerships, tie into larger grants versus going it alone. So again, if you have a community, there's no reason that you couldn't have a recovery project. Let's take broadband, connecting the hospital. And so you've got a letter of commitment from them. You've got the university, you've got a high school, you've got a mid school, you've got a number of entities, and you've created this partnership. So when the opportunity comes, you've already got the letters of commitment. You've got a 40-member coalition for this. That speaks volumes. It's not just, the city needs to hook up our city hall so we can have virtual meetings. It's, no, we got telehealth issues, we got school issues, and we've built, we've planned this backbone that's going to have redundancy, be affordable, and help our community and all 40 members of the coalition. Working on targeted priorities year after year leads to success over time. Again, keeping that focus. There are not many opportunities to offset base budget items with grant funding. So a lot of people come to the COG and they say, hey, you know, what we really need is we really need money so we can pay for overtime for our police force. What we really need is to be able to afford, you know, replacing our police safety vehicles. There's not a lot of grants that are out there. There's some that are going to supplant your local needs. So it really needs to be above and beyond some of those things. And so we can't find money to pay for the city manager, or, you know, hire a grant writer or do things that we would all like. Your community needs to prioritize those things or pay for them yourself or budget for them. Otherwise, there's just not a lot of grants out there for supplanting base budget items. You know, again, it's want versus need. You know, you want those things. You love someone else to pay for them, but they're needs that you need to come up with your local budget. So again, targeted strategies will be more effective than grant chasing. Again, don't spend a lot of time like, oh man, this grant, we could do X, Y, and Z. Well, do you really need those things, or is it just grant chasing? You know, find the things that you can connect to that move towards that vision that you really need to do. Because again, it's going to be about capacity of managing those grants. So lots of people get grants and are like, oh my God, you know, we never thought we'd get this. Well, we have no way of actually pulling this off. That's not good. Information is critical to proposal writing and shaping marketing pieces. Again, we use marketing pieces a lot. Give us a picture, give us a nice chart, give us a smiling child, you know. Those are the pieces that, you know, yeah, we've got our application, but here's our marketing piece. Here's what we're talking. Here's the story on one page that you can get your head around. That's something that differentiates you from the herd. So need access and have close relationship with public and private resources, city and county, and be pulled into the inner circle. So again, as COGs, we're always trying to build closer relationships, because I can't help you with an application if I don't know who you are, if I don't know the details, if I'm not really tuned in with your community. So we spend a lot of time just building out those relationships and getting that information, and so it's ready to be pulled together at a moment's notice. Many historical programs are moving into loan programs. Yeah, this is definitely something more and more, because they can, again, they can recycle the funding and continue to use it for other people. So grants are one time, we gave it to you, you know, if we don't get Congress to re-up it, we're done. But with a loan program, you can get paid back, and with that payback, you can continue the program. So this is a trend that's happening both at a federal and state level. There'll always be grant funding, I think, but yeah, more and more. And so you're going to need to figure out how your community, you know, like we talked about before with water rates, you know, being able to afford and finance a loan program. It's not preferred, but it may be common practice. So again, start looking at other communities and how they've, you know, gotten into these loan programs and figure out how they've done it, how they paid it off, how it's worked, how it's not worked. Nonprofit organizations are many and new ones are born every day. So track record is crucial. Again, if you're a nonprofit organization, you really have to create this track record pretty fast. You got to get small grants, do a good job, get bigger grants, and continue to climb that corporate chain foundational funding, because it's a club. If they don't know you, they're not going to open the door or their pocketbooks that wide. So again, we can probably talk offline about a whole structure and strategy for that, but I know most of you are governmental entities, so we'll just continue down the page. Build broad support and have politicians follow up on your behalf. Politics and relationships are key. This is definitely something that I know folks struggle with. But again, you know, we actually go to Washington, D.C. with several clients several times a year. And the whole idea is you're not going to get a deal when you're there, but it's getting them to know who you are, what your needs are, and then having their staff continuously get in touch with you. Hey, you know that broadband thing? Here's a new program. Here's something. Let them do some of the funneling for you. Put them to work. You know, these guys work for us. But again, you know, knowing who's in charge and how to structure a narrative. You know, there's different language for Democrats than Republicans, but there's still value in the same project. It's just how you speak to it. So learn some of those tricks of the trade, you know, and figure out what the buzzwords are with the new administration. And, you know, don't change your project, just change your team sometimes. Join grant review committees to learn and understand what funders look for. So I had one community that said, man, we get screwed on this deal every year. You know, we just don't get enough funding. And I said, well, do you sit on the committee that awards this? Oh, no, it's just people from the corridor. You know, they don't really invite us. I said, man, you got to get on that committee. So you understand exactly, you're an insider now. You're making decisions. You're reviewing the applications. You understand what they're looking for. Not that they're doing anything wrong. It's just you may not have the perspective. And again, by showing up and being on that committee, you have a voice now. So get on committees, review applications, even if it's not for your program or your deal. But understand, you know, again, you can be a better coach by being a player. You can be a better applicant by being a reviewer. And so those are just some things that I think, you know, really help for communities. So we got asked one time, you know, how do you develop a community grant program? You know, how do we set something like this up? And, you know, we kind of have been doing it naturally, so it was kind of like, okay. So anyway, these are the 10 steps for setting up an awesome community grant program. Again, a lot of these lessons are linked to things that we've talked about, but reviewing community master plan, land use plan, comprehensive plans, and ICIP priorities. You got to get that universe. You got to get that data and information. You got to have it at your fingertips in a file, whether it's virtual in the cloud or in a file drawer. Got to start building that. That's your war chest of information. And again, it's your toolbox of resources. Meet with department heads, key officials, and staff to determine and prioritize needs, projects, and goals. Again, getting that focus. Meeting with the Council of Governments. You know, if you're setting something up for a community you just moved into, I guarantee the Council of Governments has been working on this, working with that community for 50 years, probably have more information than that community has for itself. We're a great institutional resource. We have a war chest of information, and just like libraries, we'd love to give it to you. We'd love someone to use all that work, all that time, all that money that went into these plans. So anyway, meet with us. Produce and review a list, a database of current grants, past applications that were applied to, awarded. Start creating a track record, a database of what you've done, what you've gotten awarded, what you didn't get awarded. Start scoring yourself, but also just understanding where you've been will help you prepare for the future. Get copies of application, produce a database including all partners in those grants, determine a win rate, you know, how many did you apply for, how many did you get. Again, you can start achieving a better win rate, getting more focus. But again, if you don't have that stat or that metric, you know, what are you measuring yourself against? Probably can start with manager grants and contracts personnel. If you have one of those, they may have, you know, year after year, all the reports, all of the data if you're starting from scratch. So there's probably people in your institution, whether they're finance or management, that may have that information. You may be able to back into it. You can even go to the application sources. A lot of them still have them on file. Or nowadays they're moving to online, so you just get into the portal and you should be able to get a lot of that information. Again, number five, develop a stellar but boilerplate introduction that you can use for any and all grant purposes. So just start writing this, take a look at someone else's and get that so you can recycle it. Number six, compile all general background, contact, grant information, making sure you got your SAMS number, your DUNS number, your users, your passwords. There's been so many times we've had a winner and we couldn't submit it because we didn't have the right password, or we weren't current on our federal SAMS number. If you don't know what those things are, you need to start there as well and make sure your organization has all that. Because, man, if you do a lot of work and can't submit it, it's not a good Friday afternoon. And most sources won't give you an extra day or an extra hour or an extra minute. They're trying to find ways to kick people out. So make sure you have all that. Opportunity, funding opportunities. There's a New Mexico catalog of assistance that's being updated now. And I know it's a great source. It's comprehensive. Some of the sources in there won't be funded, but you just need to figure that out. It's a great place to go. We also have what's called Fund It. It's like all of these grant sources. Again, you put your project in the middle. It's about economic development projects for the most part. But man, there's so many resources. So just going to those meetings and listening and hearing projects and how people are positioning, you can learn a lot from there. They also, the New Mexico Economic Development Department has a resource map. And there's a lot of other grant finders, people that do this. Grants.gov, you should sign up. This is the federal register, basically, where all the call for projects and requests for proposals come out from the federal government. You should definitely customize this so it funnels things to you that are useful, but you need to check here. This is where, 90% of them won't be useful, but man, those 10%, if you know about them, you can attack them. Institute a grant research and management system. Again, there's paid programs like eCivis, but there's also free ones. I'm on every webinar. I got every email, newsletter, free site, just sending me emails and I scan them. Again, I find, funnel, and follow up. That's my 3 F's. I send them out to clients when I know they have projects. So the COGS can even be that tip of the spear for you. But again, you really need to be looking at these resources. Self-training, there's a lot of PowerPoints on grant writing tips. A lot of this information comes from trainings over the years. It's just very important that you're trained up to beat the competition. Interview other like communities and long-term successful grant writers to steal, we call it recycling, what they do, templates, winning applications, success they've had, funding sources that they pull in that yours doesn't. So again, you can cut through this by getting a mentor, getting someone that's in the game. And there's some good ones in New Mexico. Boy, are there. Priscilla Lucero, she's a legend from Southwest Council of Governments. Even if you're not in that region, I advise you to sit down with her for an hour. She will make your head spin, but she will put you on the track for success. Again, roll up your sleeves, learn from your mistakes, gotta jump in there. Everybody on my staff wants me to send them to grant writer training. I said, the best grant writer training is doing a grant. You just have to jump in and earn your stripes. Again, this is the Fund It website. You can see all of the different agencies, eligible projects. There's an application. There's regular meetings where we vet these projects. All the COGS sit on these. This is great. I mean, this is a great thing New Mexico did, continues to do to help bring a Shark Tank-like investment strategy to great projects. Again, this is where the resource map, you can get to that. And it breaks things down by like planning, and these are the sources, and it's getting better. It's just, it's incredible how usable these resources are, and they weren't here more than a couple years ago. So New Mexico is really trying to step its game up to make you more competitive, to make our state stronger, which I applaud. Again, these are some of those locators, email subscriptions you can join on to. Grant Plant, they have a number of like non-government sources of revenue. There's some great stuff on there. Again, grants.gov, you know, they've got it now where you can get it on your cell phone. So everything's becoming usable in real time. This is something that we put together that kind of goes through the whole deal at a local, regional, state level of how planning and project tiering works and could work better in New Mexico. But this is on our website, and I think I'm just going to skip through it right now. But it really starts with plan it, vet it, fund it. It's the key things that we've talked about in this presentation, and it kind of gives you times a year. Again, the ICIP is fundamental to the process. But this goes on to actually a second page. And then from fund it, we really talk about building the project and then reporting out the project. And so this goes through kind of, I guess, project tier, brain on the whiteboard. This is what we do day to day, year to year. And this is some of the key steps that have to happen. So again, this just puts it on kind of a two-page document, kind of the systems map. And again, we're trying to make improvements to this, trying to make it easier, trying to make it faster, trying to make it clearer, transparent, accountable to New Mexicans. So again, a lot of work's been done. This is us. I've got a number of staff that are available to the folks in my region. We'd be happy to entertain any questions, any issues from anywhere. We would advise you to get with your council of governments and hone in on this. But if there's anything we can do to be of assistance, like I said, our philosophy is that iron, you know, polishes iron. And if we make you stronger, you'll up the ante, you'll increase the competition, that'll make us stronger. And as a whole state, we'll all get stronger. So again, I appreciate you taking the time to watch this video. I know it's the extended version. Hopefully it gave you some tips, tricks, and puts you on the right track to success. I hope that you can continue to be a project here, become a project here, and make your communities better. Because at the end of the day, that's what this is all about. This is what we're all doing the work for. So again, I wish you luck. Appreciate your time and attention and focus, and please do.